You are listening to the Cycling Podcast at Our Giro d'Italia, brought to you by iWalkUp, flexible loans built for small businesses. Today, we are in Cesenatico.
Cozze citene, cozze, cozze vicine, non spigudeci cora, non spigudeci cora. Cozze citene, cozze, cozze vicine, non spigudeci cora, se non mangiano le femmine.
Where are we today, Lionel?
We're in Cesenatico, Richard, where the Giro was. Well, we were last year, weren't we, Daniel?
We had a rest day
in Cesenatico.
We had a bit of a shocker, didn't we? We were close to Cesenatico. I get all those resorts down that coast a little bit mixed up. Riccione, Rimini, Cesenatico, and we had, well, I hate to bring it up again, Lionel, but we didn't have a good evening, did we? Where were we? Riccione, I think.
Well, we'd just covered the time trial in San Marino. I'd come back from a flying visit home for the weekend to see Watford lose 6-0 in the FA Cup final, if you remember. How could anyone forget? And recorded the podcast completely wrongly on the wrong channels with the microphones plugged into the wrong. So we lost an entire take of an entire episode and we had to redo
it. Guys, can you just check your levels and stuff that is running okay?
Yeah, all running fine. Excellent. And Daniel took it extremely well. I must admit, I was quite tired by that stage. I've been up since about 4:30 in the morning. Daniel took it really well when I said we've got to redo it from the start. But then at the end, he dropped the bombshell and said, well, we were going to have a lovely dinner in a restaurant in a town a short drive away, but now we are going to just have a bog standard pizza, which, I mean, it was all right, the pizza, wasn't it?
But it was all right.
You ran the advert of what we were missing. You kept mentioning what we were missing as we were tucking into our pizza.
You had a bit of a Victor Campenaerts, did you, that day?
I damned you with false magnanimity. Magnanimity? Yeah, I think it's a word.
Yeah, biting your tongue, I think. That's right. That was the day Campenaerts would have won the time trial had he not had a mechanical issue on the final climb, wasn't it?
And I wonder who was more irritated that evening, Victor Campenaerts or Lionel Birnie? You know, to whom does it mean more, a nice dinner or a time trial victory in the Giro?
I think
that's very close.
I think they're on a par.
I think so.
A corrections corner, no such word as magnanimity.
Magnanimity, yeah, I wasn't listening properly. I was trying to remember who it was, had the nightmare and the time trial. It was racking my brain. Then it came to me all of a sudden. What's coming up today, Lionel?
Well, we are going to pick up Max Sciandri's story a little bit. We reached the point where he was just about to become British. We'll pick that up and then we'll talk a little bit about the Linda McCartney team's experience at the 2000 Giro and the 2000 Giro as a whole. Quite a dramatic one. And, that was Marco Pantani's return, wasn't it, after being kicked out of the race in 1999. That was heavily dramatic, wasn't it? But the 2000 Giro was... had its moments as well. So as we are in Cesenatico, Marco Pantani's hometown, he will feature heavily in today's episode.
Tale of the Tappa then, please, Lionel.
Well, we're going around in a big circle, Daniel, starting and finishing in Cesenatico. 2,000 kilometres? No. You might be a sadistic race.
Not even
race.
I would plot a 2,000 kilometre time trial.
Not quite, no. Not a time trial, though, is it? It's a 203 kilometre road stage. 3,500 metres of climbing would have been ahead for
it's
them.
It's pretty much, I don't know how closely this mimics the course of the Nove Colli Gran Fondo, a very famous Gran Fondo founded in 1971. Is it the biggest in the world? I think that's one of the taglines they use, or one of the most famous Gran Fondos in the world anyway.
But if you're riding along on the RGT platform, riding our Giro, you'll be relieved to know that today is another traditional transitional stage, some late rerouting of the course in this middle week of the Giro. Daniel smirking there, that I think probably disappointed that it's been made easier for us. But we'll be riding 34.9 kilometres, a little bit of a climb at the start, but then downhill and flat to the finish. My kind of stage. So let's hear how we're getting on the course.
Just before we do, Lionel, this invective that's being spewed my way is race director. I can't help but remember something. One of my predecessors on the Giro, one of my one of the former Giro directors, Angelo Zomignan, said in 2009 when Lance Armstrong sort of orchestrated a rider protest in Milan because of a stage that went over some tram tracks. Zomanyan, in response to that, said the course requires explosive power and riders to get their butts out of the saddle. Apparently some older riders have no desire to do so. Instead, it seems as though their legs are shorter while their tongues have become longer.
Good for podcasting. Strong. He's not going to send us over tram tracks as well, is he, Lionel?
Strong echoes of what's currently happening on our Giro.
Well, let's hear how we're getting on in the saddle.
Birds chirruping in the trees, a radio playing in the background, a hammer banging somewhere, but no infernal turbo trainer churning away on another stage of our Giro. I am afraid I'm a DNS today. That's me reclining in my chair. I will ride the stage later, but too late, I'm afraid, for today's podcast. Lionel and I did do yesterday's stage last night in a group ride, and in fact ended up riding into the finish together. We rode for quite a long time in each other's company before our really closely contested sprint. I'm pleased to report that the winner was me. Sorry, Lionel.
You are listening to the Cycling Podcast at Our Giro d'Italia. Brought to you by iWaka, flexible loans built for small businesses. iwoca.co.uk.
Yes, a big thank you to our lovely title sponsor, iWaka, and some breaking iWaka news as of Wednesday, yesterday, that's pretty significant. They've been accredited by the British Business Bank to offer CBILS, that's the Coronavirus Business Interruption Loan Scheme, CBILS for short. It's a scheme that was set up by the government to help small businesses impacted by coronavirus, and it's a very big deal for iWaka and their customers, who can now borrow between £50,000 and one pence and £250,000 as part of this scheme at very favourable terms. There's no interest, no repayments in the first 12 months. You only start repaying after a year so that your business has the breathing space to recover. The first 12 months of interest are paid by the government, and there's no personal guarantee required, so no personal liability. iWaka will operate in the same way with a straightforward online application. If you're interested in a CBILS, you can register that interest now at iwaka.co.uk. And while you're there, there's an awful lot of information on the iWaka website, on iWaka's COVID hub, about the various financial support schemes available to small businesses. Not all of them administered or offered by iWaka, but they're nonetheless, because they're nice like that.
Amarcord. I remember.
Say, Napalm, you went Piadina. I went Crescione. Difference?
Yours looks like thinner bread, more like a pitta pocket. Mine is sort of flatbread sausage sandwich.
Yeah, the filling of mine looks somewhat healthier than yours.
Yeah, it does. Yeah, yours is green. But I've got some onions.
Go on then, give us your verdict.
Feels like a sausage sandwich from home.
Lo scatto di Pantani, avevo detto due erano le possibilità per Pantani, o puntare alla vittoria di tappa o puntare alla classifica. Ecco il testa a testa più atteso, Ulrich nella scia di Pantani. Pantani, Ulrich.
So Napalm, we've been to the Spazio Pantani, the museum, and we've just had a piadina from the piadineria Pantani.
Yeah, well, the most remarkable thing was how much like Marco Pantani the man at the next table looked. Shaved head, sticky out ears. I mean, I was convinced he was, I don't know, an uncle or a cousin or an older brother or something. But no,
nothing to do with him. Nothing to do with him. But there is a lot in Cesenatico that is in Pantani's honour. Clearly, his sort of spectre looms large still here, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. The thing about the museum shop was that all of the memorabilia was fantastic. I mean, it was a real sort of treasure trove of Pantani's career and achievements, jerseys, trophies, bikes. But the sense that Pantani's still a commodity is, you know, lingers in there with that some of the souvenirs were a little bit tacky. I'm not sure anyone needs a Marco Pantani signature cigarette lighter, for example, do they?
Well, some of the proceeds do go to charity. There's a Marco Pantani foundation. But no, I take your point. You know, Pantani, I suppose, always was someone whose image was manipulated, used in a period in sort of Italian cycling, Italian sport, when they were on the lookout for an icon, and they got one in Pantani. And it was, you know, a period when Italians really dominated professional cycling. And those days are gone, aren't they? But Pantani's legend certainly hasn't gone. There's a kind of a mawkish nostalgia, not just for Pantani, but for that period. You know, we're in a part of Italy now on the Adriatic coast where cycling has really been eclipsed and almost obliterated by motorsport. This is a huge area for motorsport, and a lot of the same things that were projected onto Pantani have since been projected onto particularly MotoGP pilots, people like Valentino Rossi, you know, who's seen as a kind of anti-establishment figure, a bit of an iconoclast, in the same way that Pantani was.
The one thing I keep thinking about Pantani is how much of that marketability was created when he decided to shave off his hair. Because when he won the white jersey in the Giro, best young rider, I mean, he looked about 48 then, with the kind of the width. And I can say this as somebody who lost his hair prematurely, that moment you make to shave it all off is quite a significant thing. But he kind of became a much more confident character on and off the bike, I think, but and yet retain that kind of vulnerability, and, you know, all of the things about his physical appearance that must have kind of influenced and affected his character. And that's something that's always interested me.
Well, Daniel, that was a year ago on the Giro when we dropped into the Pantani family's piadineria. Is that right?
Yes.
Excellent. You were doing your best Louis Theroux impression, weren't you? Trying to see if Marco Pantani's sister would want to talk about Marco Pantani.
Employing my sort of faux naive shtick in the hope that it would tease out some podcasting gold. Wasn't the case, was it?
It wasn't really, no. You didn't have the ruthless streak. You demurred, really, didn't you? And, you know, withdrew from pushing too hard. And then we sat down, and I was feeling some eyeballs bearing into the side of my face from a gentleman at the other table who looked so much like Marco Pantani's older brother, I literally couldn't believe it. But it turned out that he thought I looked like Bjarne Riis. I don't know who should have been more offended there, really, Bjarne or me. There we are. Anyway, I was really taken by the sandwiches, the little flatbread sandwiches, so I had a go at making some for our Giro.
Il ristorante.
The piadina is a flatbread. It's from the Romagna region, and it's, I think the easiest way to think about it, if you're not familiar with it, is it's kind of like an Italian tortilla. It's a sort of non-leavened, unlike a pizza, which is risen with yeast and cooked in an oven. A piadina is it's just a flatbread with no raising agents, and it's cooked on a very hot sort of bake stone or griddle, more like a tortilla. And traditionally, it was made with whatever flour they had to hand, so it could be made with acorn flour or chestnut flour. These days, it's almost always wheat flour. Generally, traditionally, it's got lard in it because that gives it a lovely flaky texture. But obviously, you can make it vegetarian with olive oil or vegetable oil. And then you use it like a sort of sandwich filling. So you put in, a sandwich bread. So you can put in prosciutto, cheese, rockets, delicious things like that. You put it in hot and then you fold it over and eat it immediately while it's still warm. And they are so delicious. I think they should be better known. I might start up a piadina chain in Britain, actually. That's my next project.
Excellent. I might get there first. Maybe I could just do knock out some piadina. I mean, they're once you've got the pan hot, it's a doddle.
I actually have never made them. Oh god, you have got a march on me. I need to start practicing for when lockdown ends.
Now, I made my dough here using one of your colleague Rachel Roddy's recipes, and it worked a treat. A real nice flat bread, rolled it out nice and thin, pricked it with a fork, and then put it into a hot, dry pan, and you just get that little bubbly effect on the outside of the bread, and then filled with, we had a mix, really. We had some mozzarella, tomato and basil, we had some prosciutto, and then we also had some cheese and Nduja sausage, and then basically you fold over the bread and keep it
Put it back in the pan till the filling sort of warms and melts a bit, and lovely lunch sandwiches.
I would say that, and I mean this in a very positive sense. They reminded me of something that I've had in an Italian service station. So actually, that's quite a professional. I'm sure the fillings were nicer, but they had quite a professional look to it in the picture. You sent a little bit of a slightly rustic appearance in the shape. They weren't perfectly Pac-Man round, but I think these are good effort. I've actually never made these myself, so I'm thinking that if you can do it, maybe I can also wow. have a go. So wow. yeah,
damned with the faintest of praise there. I did consider cutting the using a side plate and cutting them till they were perfectly round, but I thought no, an authentic piadineria would just live with the little imperfections. Maybe a job at Fatty Furbo awaits me. That's the service station that Daniel always tries to catch me standing in front of the big Fatty Furbo sign when we're covering the Giro.
Well, as well as being a boss with a fearsome reputation and having run quite a few very successful cycling teams, Bjarne Riis makes some cracking flatbread sandwiches, doesn't he?
I'm surprised to see Lionel here on the podcast today, because I've been lobbying for him to be exiled like the old House of Savoy when Italy became a republic in 1946, because of he accompanied some arrosticini the other day with salad cream or
not
mayonnaise.
Salad cream. Aioli. A lovely garlic mayonnaise, which, I mean, actually it went on the roasted potatoes more than the lamb, but it went very well. I mean, this kind of tiring kind of culinary elitism is really boring, isn't it? I mean, if you want to put pineapple on a pizza, that's absolutely fine, Daniel. It doesn't affect you.
Especially
tinned pineapple.
In a very terse text exchange earlier today, Lionel, I did send you a famous quote from an Italian writer, Leo Longanesi, who said of the Italians, let me just find it, hang on, where is it?
While you're looking for that, Daniel, my brother used to swear by banana and tuna pizza.
Oh, good grief.
What do you think of that?
Where is it? Hang on a sec.
Just no response to that whatsoever.
He said, "The Italian is totalitarian in the kitchen, democratic in parliament, Catholic in bed, and communist in the factory." And Lionel, that's the way it should remain, as far as I'm concerned. Tyranny is coming back in fashion.
Well, speaking of restaurants, Max Sciandri, we heard in yesterday's episode about his upbringing a little bit, and his father is a restaurateur now in LA, but we're going to catch up with Max today on the sort of mid-90s when he switched from being an Italian to being a British rider.
In that period, you know, your results were good enough to be selected for Italy for the World Championships, but you weren't really getting into the team. I mean, obviously they had so many different leaders that they could pick, and was that what eventually led to you deciding that it would be better for your career to take out the British license?
No, exactly. Probably one of the saddest parts of my career was literally throwing away 3 or 4 years of my first years as a pro, when I was really winning 6, 7, 8 races a year and being one of the strongest riders in the Italian scenario, and not being able to go into the Worlds. The Worlds, what Lance won in Oslo, I was flying that year. I was literally flying. I won Veneto. I won Giro del Veneto with 4 guys what just came back from the Worlds. So it was like Giovannetti, Furlan, Chiappucci and somebody else. And I just literally played with them. I was so strong. I was really deserved. So one of my biggest regrets is literally not having done 3 or 4 World Championships as a bike rider that I really deserved to go. So that's when I just had to take the decision of picking a British license. And
I mean, let's explain to the listeners here, because British cycling of 1995 was nothing like British cycling of, the year 2000 or 2005 or how it is today.
Exactly. It was nothing. And in UK, and UCI allowed you to take a license. So you could just pick a license. And then obviously now the rule has gone down to, like, you have to take a license of your of your residence nation and so on and so on. It's still always a little bit strange even in today's. But in them days, I just applied for a license. Just applied for a license, got a British license, and there I was. They gave me a jersey, and that's all they gave you at the days, and I think arm warmers. And there I was. I was racing for the British license.
Can you remember how that all worked? Because I mean, again, 95. You know, the internet was just starting. But I mean, how did you get in contact? I guess you'd have to ring somebody up. Is that how it worked?
Yeah, for sure. I can't really remember who helped me out, but I remember Doug Daly was the coach in the days, and it was a fantastic person. And I can't remember who really helped me out. It was maybe some ex-pro down the road would stop what I saw in some race, or I had to call somebody. I can't really remember.
And so let me just get the timeline right here, because in 1995 you rode the Tour de France and you won a stage into Saint-Étienne as a British rider.
Yeah.
A memorable day. I mean, Britain had had time trialists, really. I mean, Chris Boardman had won a prologue, Sean Yates had won, but I think it had been probably since Robert Miller would have been the last person to have won a road stage in the Tour. I mean, a pretty big deal at the time.
Yeah, it was a big deal, but you know, the whole British scenario was just kind of starting to grow and to grow and to get bigger and bigger, and you know, I wasn't really aware of the whole. I just wanted that license basically, and to do the worlds. That was my main, sadly, for the whole British thing, was that's what I aimed at. I just wanted to do the worlds and obviously represent yourself and the country. And obviously with the British cycling, it came more maybe representing myself, because there was no organization at all. As you said, it was literally one of them smaller countries what just showed up at the worlds and had to split the team car, and only three riders were allowed, and that was it. That was the scenario in the days.
So your first Worlds as a British rider was Colombia in 95?
Yeah.
And so you would have presumably taken on quite a leadership sort of role with some riders who were racing domestic races in the UK and you know, perhaps not as experienced on that big stage.
No, it was pretty funny, because I was in MG that year, and then with Pascal Richard, Rolf Sorensen, Cassani, four of us, we paid a swanee, and we decided to go out 2 weeks earlier to acclimatise to altitude, and something we did on our own with our own money. So here we are, we went into Duitama, and I get there the first day, and the day after I said, okay, let me go and ride the course. And I went out and ride the course, and I was like, whoa, this is like up one side, down the other side, 2K flat, up. And is this a world sort? Then I remember I got sick. It was just a nightmare for me that year, that Worlds. And I remember the team was a small team. And the funny story is, when I went back, you know, I got a few interviews with Italian papers, and I said, hey, I had this teammate who was actually a plumber, and he's called Chris Lillywhite. And every time he's... But then we're friends, because I saw him even last year in Tour of Britain. And I was like, hey, Chris. And I think we even ended up racing in Linda McCartney, but it was just funny, because in Italy, here you are winning races and not getting selected. And then in the British scenario, a guy what was a plumber and a bike rider as a nobby is in the world. So that was a little bit of the story of the two sides.
And then, of course, the following year was the Olympic Games in Atlanta. And you're in the team again with another kind of mixed bunch of riders representing Great Britain.
Yeah, I can't remember the names, really, if you tell me. Oh. I remember Miller was there when he did the time trial, and I remember Doug Daly very well, and I remember that race, obviously, and the whole thing. It was great.
Because, of course, Chris Boardman was...
I remember Chris Boardman was there because Indurain gave me a little... Because Indurain won the time trial, didn't he?
That's right. No, Indurain won the time trial, and Chris Boardman got a bronze medal.
And I know why, exactly. I can tell you a little inside story what Indurain and Miguel, because we became friends, said he won it because I think Boardman chose to ride with one chain ring. And he said, and it was pretty rolling. And he said he had the advantage of being able to go shift down to a smaller chainring, but he put him on a bigger one, though. Instead of, a, like, let's say a 42, he had a 44. So that's why he told me, he said he won it. This is a little thing that we chatted a lot about it after, but I never really spoke about it to Chris, so I don't know.
I'm struggling a bit to find the men's riders. There wouldn't have been many of them, would there?
Nah, probably three.
Yeah, Brian Smith.
Yeah, exactly, Brian Smith, yeah.
John Tanner.
Yeah.
Malcolm Elliott, who was racing in LA at the time for the Chevrolet team, or racing in the States. And that's it, you.
Wow.
I think that's it. Yeah, I mean, you got into a break with Richard and Sorensen, and
no, earlier. So basically, earlier I was I was the last lap. I was dead. I was on my knees because I went in a break earlier with Frankie Andreo, I think, and Metro Maori, what had won the Vuelta. I think it was a break of three or four. And we're out in this break for a couple laps. Then the peloton catches the break. And then I slip away again with Pascal and Rolf Sorensen. So I was out for like a double break. And I was dead. The last lap, I was dead. But the funny story is, I'll give you a little story. So we're in the Olympic camp. And we come out of the camp, and it's me and Rolf. We're riding out the camp. And I remember a lot of security. Oh, it was like metal detectors, fingerprint, eye. So basically, we come out of the camp, and we meet Pascal. And we're trying to go and see the course. And Pascal says, let's go and see the finish. So the day before, us three, we're riding up to the finish line. And there's this big wide road, American road, just pulling up a 3%, 2-3%. And us three are riding, and the day after the finish, we're us three again. That's such a funny story.
It was it was a strange old course, wasn't it? I mean, it was like racing around a neighborhood, really.
It was a neighborhood course, and there's all these little rolling up and downs in the woods, a bit of trees, shelter. Then it was really humid, I remember, boiling hot. I remember looking at Chippo after three or four laps. His face was like red as a beetroot. And I said, oh, he's not good today.
And it was the first Olympics that the pros could do.
First Olympics, exactly, yeah.
And I mean, was it a big deal when you know, for British cycling and Doug Daly? I mean, I remember Doug Daly sort of saying, because it was a pretty bad Olympics for Great Britain overall. They didn't do much in many sports, and there weren't terribly many medalists. I mean, you were one of you and Boardman were, you know, considering the size of the cycling team across road and track, really delivered. I mean, it was a good result for cycling. And I think Doug Daly, from talking to him, you know, he did say, look, there could be some talent here, that, you know, that it was kind of the thing that kick-started a little bit, the British cycling putting some funding into cycling. Now, I know they focused it initially on the track, but it was almost like the first day of the revolution in a way.
No, for sure. I mean, I became aware of what I did. And I remember when I came home, I had a lot of interviews from Italian media saying this could have been an Italian medal, you know, because I think Olympics and meddling is a politic thing, you know. It's like a nation really is proud of if you get their medals, and in Italy, really kind of said at one point, that could have been our medal, and they looked a little bit into the whole thing of like why I didn't get selected. And I really made a lot of noise about the whole system of Italy. Was very, I don't say done it badly, but, you know, Italy is the way they chose. It wasn't on results. It was like more of friendship, and I'm a leader, and I'm going to bring this guy, and he's a leader. He's going to bring two guys, and that's how Italy was built. So I just said what I had to say in 10 days, but it was a British medal, so.
Do you remember much about coming into the, you know, the last bit, the three of you together, and, you know?
No,
you...
I remember Rolf and Pascal, they hated each other, and they're teammates. They've even been teammates, but they hated each other. And I got on with both of them super well. So I was like, shit, I'm going to flake both of these guys. But I was dead. And Rolf was like, hey, I'm going to try and attack at 2K to go. Don't chase me. And Pascal was like, I'm going to do the sprint. Can you help me? And I was like, I'm going to flick both of them. But I was literally on my knees, and the humidity was high, and we didn't get drinks enough. And
also, you've got a lot to lose in a 3-man break there. You've got a lot to gain. Yeah. There's a medal.
But I knew the medal was in the pocket, and I said I couldn't stand a sprint 1-1. I just didn't have the legs, and I said I'm going to try and jump around 500 or 600 meters, and I see if I can just have enough energy to make a jump and open a little gap, and they can kind of look at each other. But it didn't happen, obviously, and I just got blown away in the sprint. I wasn't even in the picture. But at the end of the day, you're on the podium, and that Olympic medal is still, you know, it's a bronze, it's still valuable, and still...
Where is the medal today?
It's one of the only things I probably have in my house as my whole career, is that medal. I don't have no trophies from the Giro wins, the Tour wins, or... Well, any other race I won, that's the only thing I have.
The Cycling Podcast at Our Giro d'Italia is supported by Science in Sport. Science in Sport, fueled by science.
Thank you very much to our longtime sponsors, Science in Sport, who have been backing us since the 2016 Giro d'Italia. And if you want 25% off all your lovely Science in Sport products, go to scienceandsport.com, enter the code SISCP25. A big reason for Science in Sport's support of the podcast is their chief executive, Stephen Moon, who is a listener. And, he emailed me about an episode we had a few days ago over the weekend. We did a two-parter on Mario Cipollini, and Stephen emailed with his own Cipollini tale. He went into a very premium bike shop in southwest London, he writes, because I had a double puncture and wanted a couple of tubes. There was an £11,000 bike in the window, etc., that sort of bike shop. I asked the owner about the nutrition he had on offer. There were 3 brands, and SIS was prominent. He was very sneery, said Stephen, and said, I only make pennies on that stuff. Pennies. I don't know why I bother. I mentioned that I was in the industry but didn't claim my allegiance, and that sent him off on the same rant. I countered with, but you never know when someone buying a gel might see that bike out of the corner of their eye and register it for a later purchase. He wasn't having it. The door then burst open, and 3 guys looking at extras from Gamora blew into the shop. At the front was a lantern-jawed, deeply tanned, long leather coat-wearing Cipollini. Behind him, 2 almost stereotypically hard-looking Italian security guys. He looked around the shop, and I was slack-jawed as he alighted on the Science and Sport product and double-fisted gels, proclaiming loudly, "These are the best. I always use these." I would never get a job in sales, says Stephen, as I quietly slipped out of the shop, leaving the owner to extol the virtues of what were apparently now his favourite gels too. So Cipollini apparently was on his way from Gatwick to the cycle show for the launch of his bike range. So Stephen, a bystander there, as Mario Cipollini grabbed a couple of fistfuls of Science and Sport gels. And you've been doing that the last 10 days or so, haven't you, Lionel, regularly during your RGT rides?
Certainly have, although my supplies are not as extensive as yours, because, well, you've got a huge consignment of stuff and you've not sent me any. You're supposed to have sent me a few gels and bars just to keep going.
I think I might need them all for myself, so apologies for that. But yeah, you'll survive. You're only doing the Intergiro anyway. On with the show. So we heard from Max Sciandri, and he rode the 2000 Giro d'Italia for a British team, and we'll hear about that in a moment or two. But that 2000 Giro was far more significant than being the only one with a British professional team. We spoke in our very first Our Giro episode about the 1946 Giro, the Giro of rebirth. And in its own way, the 2000 Giro was also a kind of Giro of rebirth as well, wasn't it?
Are you talking about Marco Pantani, Rich?
I am, yeah, because his expulsion in 1999 really sent shockwaves through the world of cycling, but really, I would have thought, damaged the Giro, didn't it?
Yeah, I think it did. But you know what was most extraordinary about the months that followed leading up to the 2000 tour was that Pantani, the 2000 Giro, was that Pantani completely disappeared in the sense that he didn't race at all in the rest of 1999. He could have come back, of course, 2 weeks later because it wasn't a doping ban; it was only a health ban. Although you know. Plenty of people drew from that, inferred that he had actually used doping products. But yeah, he could have come back 2 weeks later, didn't race again in 1999. In 2000, he sort of went to training camps at Mercatone Uno, talked a lot about making a comeback. He went to a couple of races in Spain. He did two stages of the Vuelta Valenciana in February, I think, and then got off. Pulled out at the last minute a couple more one-day races in Spain and then again sort of disappeared, went AWOL. We found out later that this, he had started to take cocaine and to abuse cocaine soon after his ejection from the Giro in 1999. So how much of that was going on early in 2000, we don't know. But yeah, he disappeared after those aborted comeback attempts in the spring. And no one saw him in March, really. No one saw him in April. And it was widely accepted that he wasn't going to ride the Giro. But the couple of public appearances he did make in that spring were to do with court cases that had arisen out of doping allegations. There was one involving Michele Ferrari, and he was called as a witness. He was called to give evidence on the 4th of May. The Giro was starting on the 14th of May. And he left, I don't know whether it was a magistrate's court or police station that day where he gave evidence, but he came out that day basically saying there was no chance that he was going to ride the Giro. You know, they asked him who he thought it would win the Giro, and he sort of enigmatically said, the winner will be the guy who finishes first, and the guy who finishes second will finish second, helpfully. And, there were opinion pieces the next day in the Italian newspapers. One I read, I think it was in La Stampa, under the headline, The Bitter Surrender. And we all pretended to believe that we'd see Marco Pantani at the start of the Giro, but none of us would have bet 30 cents on it. In sport, and above all in cycling, which is a beastly exercise, there's dust and sweat, but no miracles. Setting aside a tentative return in Spain in February, Marco has been absent from racing for 11 months, an eternity for anyone thinking about tackling a three-week race. We're astonished and dismayed that there's still no plan, no idea, no promise. Pantani is saying the same things today that he said 11 months ago and at the start of the season. I'll come back when I've found inner peace again. So that was the 4th of May. On the 5th of May, Gino Bartali died. Now, Gino Bartali, a couple of weeks before his death, had said publicly he hoped Pantani got it together and could somehow make it to the start of the Giro. On the 11th of May, Pantani is now saying, there are news crews that have started trying to interview him at his home in Cesenatico. He now says he might come back. And the fact that Bartali had made those declarations or said those things a few weeks earlier might influence his decision, and he might try and give it a go. At this point, on the 11th of May, the Italian newspapers started to speculate, and there was a story that he already had a flight reservation or a ticket for a plane that was going from Bologna to Rome a couple of days before the Giro was due to start. So that was the 11th of May. Race started on the 14th. On, I think, the 12th or the 13th, he arrived in Rome. And even then, when he had arrived in Rome, he said that he might not take part. And, it was a fantastic Italian melodrama. There was going to be this sort of papal blessing for the riders at the Vatican. I mean, it couldn't have been more melodramatic. And I remember I was doing my exams at university at the time and probably wasn't following all of this in the Italian newspapers. I think I managed to get hold of a copy of La Gazzetta on the day itself when, the eve of the race itself. I sound a bit like Bradley Wiggins now. Managed to get a copy of La Gazzetta in Kilburn High Road. And I just could not believe this because I don't think I was really party to all of the rumours of the days before. And as far as I was concerned, this had just come out of nowhere. Pantani was done and dusted pretty much as a professional cyclist. And then all of a sudden, here he was at the start of the Giro. And people, were even suggesting that he was going to win the race.
Well, let's hear what it was like to be on the ground there and be part of the Giro entourage and to be looking out for Pantani, because it appears that a lot of the riders and other teams were equally in the dark about whether Pantani was going to appear or not. And we're going to hear a bit more from him later, but John Deering was the press officer for the Linda McCartney team, and he was one of the people there on the ground, unsure about whether Pantani would turn up for the 2000 Giro.
I remember being worried for everybody all the time. You know, when you're standing outside the road, sort of biting your nails and stuff. It was hot. It was a really hard route. And people go mental for Pantani everywhere we went. He'd been banned from the Giro the year before, wasn't it? He got chucked out the penultimate day. But nobody really knew if he was going to be there or not. And in those days, there was only a couple of teams that had big buses, and a lot of the races wouldn't let riders travel on the team coaches. You had to go in like official race buses. So there was a lot more mixing between the teams and stuff. And we had, we went to the Vatican for the race to meet the Pope. And we went to the Mercatonino Hotel to pick them up, and everybody, including all the riders, like Dario Frigo, all up against the window in the coach, looking to see if Pantani's going to come out of this hotel or not. And typically Pantani, for a bit of drama, he left it to all the rest of the team and staff were on, and then came out the door last. Yeah, and then we went to the Vatican.
Hey, it's Mitch Stocker here from Life in the Peloton. It's the Giro d'Italia time, and in typical fashion, I've gone and searched out some Giro stories of my own. 2014 was my highlight for me. We won the team's time trial in Belfast, and I've gone back and spoken to 8 of the 9 guys, got their story. We've talked about the day before, the day of, and the day after, and also some other great Giro stories. If you haven't heard it, go back and listen to it, or go and listen to it right now, because this is a really, really good episode.
Well, I think the sense from that 2000 Giro was that Marco Pantani's results might have been fairly anonymous, but his presence certainly wasn't. He was still the big draw in the race, wasn't he? Finished 28th overall, and there were flashes of his previous form. He finished second on a stage to Briançon right near the end of the race, and it was clear that he was still the most charismatic figure in Italian cycling, even though, you know, the race was led for a long time by Francesco Casagrande and eventually won by Stefano Garzelli, who in a way was almost a Pantani lookalike, wasn't he? That none of them had the star factor that
No, Napalm, and indeed, in the first week of that Giro, the press understandably wanted to speak to no one else, really, and the other riders on other teams started to get quite upset about this, so much so that Pantani imposed a sort of press ban on himself and said that he wasn't going to speak to the press anymore for a few days because, you know, the other riders had made their feelings clear. He was getting too much attention, and, you know, he thought this would be a noble gesture not to give any more interviews. And the only thing he did on one of the days when he wasn't speaking to the press was he took the arm of the post-race reporter or the race reporter from Rai Television, Alessandra De Stefano, who still does that job, and he bit her arm on live TV, which you probably wouldn't get away with these days, would you? I don't think...
Did you get away with it in those days?
Well, yeah, you did. But this was, you know, kind of typical of Pantani, ever enigmatic. And there was feverish anticipation for the first mountain stage, which was finishing at Abetone, which we mentioned a couple of days ago when we were talking about Alberto Tomba. But in a big mountain stage over San Pellegrino in Alpe, a really fantastic and very hard climb in Tuscany. But until that point, no one really knew whether Pantani would indeed, you know, be a contender to win. And Stefano Garzelli, who went on to win the race, he spent sort of the early part of that climb of San Pellegrino in Alpe sort of dropping back and helping Pantani. Pantani couldn't hold the best wheels, and Garzelli looked as though he was just going to ride his Pantani's Domestique. And then finally he got the all clear to go ahead. and ended up finishing, you know, close to the front of the race. And they fell out that night, or Garzelli and Pantani fell out, but Pantani particularly fell out with Giuseppe Martinelli, his director sportif, who had been his DS for the Tour and the Giro that he'd won in 1998. And they never really patched it up after that. But then Pantani did have this great moment, as you mentioned, Napalm, on the stage to Briançon late in the race. And it was, you know, again, fantastic sort of symbolism and drama about this, because it was on the Izoard where he was sort of revived and resuscitated. The Izoard was a climb, you know, in France, so the race had gone over the French border, but the Izoard has a great history, a great association with Italian riders. Gino Bartali had, I can't remember the year it was, but Bartali is one of the names that's synonymous with the Izoard and great exploits there. So
48, no?
I think you remember. Yeah. And Pantani came back to life there and essentially, well, ended up really saving Garzelli's skin and helping him to ultimately win that Giro.
Pantani was kind of trapped in a circus of partly his own making by this stage, though, wasn't he? I mean, that whole period from getting kicked out of the Giro right towards the end of the 1999 race, he was, you know, that elevated his status, and he became a victim for the paparazzi, didn't he? I remember over that winter there were sort of pictures in the press of his car half up the pavement, driving the wrong way down a one-way street. You know, everything he did was in the public eye and gave a sense that he was kind of unravelling. It was probably a bit of a press construct, but obviously there was some substance behind it as well. And the fact that he was out of action for close to 12 months and came back to the Giro and was reasonably competitive and then went into the Tour de France, which ended up being his final Tour de France, as one of the thorns in Lance Armstrong's side, really. One of the biggest dangers, even though eventually he didn't finish the race. I mean, this was the Tour de France of the famous side-by-side race up Mont Ventoux, Armstrong and Pantani going to the line together, and Armstrong allowing Pantani to take the stage win and then regretting it because Pantani didn't show enough gratitude. And then came the famous... That's right, yeah, the unflattering nickname and the no gifts press conference quote. Pantani won again at Courchevel a few days later, and then on the stage to Morzine, the last real mountain stage of the Tour, was up the road. Was this the day that Johan Bruneel got onto the phone to Michele Ferrari and said, can Pantani put us in difficulty here? Because Pantani had risen up the classification to sixth place, was still many minutes down on Armstrong, but they clearly didn't want to take any chances. And when Pantani kind of started bridging up to the group that was up the road, starting to look more and more of a danger, Bruneel got on the phone to check whether Pantani would be any eventual threat. And kind of the boom and bust of Marco Pantani's career sort of symbolised in a day and a half, really. He was off the front, looking dangerous, then he was caught, then he was dropped, and then the following morning he didn't start, and that was his last brush with the Tour de France. He did, of course, ride the Giro a couple more times after that.
It was the last time he really looked like Pantani, the 2000 Tour. I mean, I always thought it was quite telling and quite sad, quite poignant, when a couple of years later he had his ears pinned back. I mean, we made reference there to the Elefantino nickname, but that sort of showed how uncomfortable he was in his own skin. But he also, you know, it made him look very different, and he looked much older, actually, and he was sort of unrecognizable from the, you know, from the rider who had excited everyone in the late 90s. But I always think with Pantani, and you know, the 2000 Tour sort of fits into this, that more than the intensity of the passion and the love for him when he was there and he was performing, I think what makes him so powerful, or makes his legacy so powerful, is the intensity of the longing and these long periods of longing for Pantani to be back and performing again throughout his career. So he came on the scene in 94 and won stages of the Giro, and then 95 as well, and was brilliant at the Tour de France. But then he had his terrible accident in Milan-Turin, was absent, was gone for over a year, came back in 1997, and you know, even there missed or crashed out of the Giro. brilliant in 1998, but then 1999 happens and he's gone again at Madonna di Campiglio. And, you know, again, several months away, in which people are sort of, you know, they're remembering the intensity of the emotions that he transmitted, and they're imagining what he might do when he comes back. He comes back very briefly, gives another tantalizing glimpse, and then he's gone again. And it was almost like an unrequited sort of love. And I think that that is one reason why he was sort of held in the regard, and that he still is.
Sorry to drag the conversation onto more prosaic matters, but speaking of intensity and longing and tantalizing, is it time for
Vino del Giorno? Chin chin.
As the cycling podcast Full Giro and Baby Giro now wind its way up to the Marca region, we're looking at the Chu Chu Lacrima di Mora d'Alba. Now, this particular wine is made of 100% from Lacrima grape, which really exhibits sort of a black ink appearance, you know, with some cherry, mulberry and almost lavender violet sort of notes coming through. Now, this particular wine itself does not have a huge tannic structure, so in my opinion that makes it really appropriate for just general easy drinking. So very good for a midweek drinker, especially if you're having some charcuterie, some lighter cheeses, maybe some lighter meats in the mix there, chicken, pork and things like that. But really, we like it as a good versatile drinker, and we hope you enjoy it too.
Bit of wine nice. Region doping today,
nice
to us, because this wine today is from the Marche, and we're not in Le Marche. And in fact, our Giro, did it briefly go into Le Marche yesterday? Well, when we were on our way from Trevi to
Oh, I can't Cesena. Remember. It's all a blur.
Daniel. It's all a blur
to
you.
I might have been sleeping in the car at that point.
This is a very rare grape variety, Lacrima, from Morro d'Alba, nothing to do with the Alba in Piedmont, which is very close to Barolo and Barbaresco, which we'll be talking about. But what do you think, Rich? You're getting some sort of stewed strawberries there. Very unusual scent, this wine, no?
Very unusual.
Yeah, is that it? You've dried up all of your, you know, it's, your florid
dry,
descriptions of the
quite,
sort of second quite, half of the first
yeah,
week. Of,
yeah, I used it all up. I used up all my gooseberries and tannins and licorices in the first week. Lionel, you got anything to say about it?
Well, I'm teetotal again today. Sorry about that. Am I right in thinking this wine is made from grapes, Daniel?
Oh, dear. Dear.
On with the 2000 Giro. Well, we're going to hear again for a bit from Max Sciandri, aren't we? And a reminder that the full Max Sciandri opus is available for friends of the
Super
podcast.
Super Tuscan.
What's that? The Super Tuscan is on. It was a long conversation you had with him, Lionel. The life of Max Sciandri, that's available for friends of the podcast. So is Daniel's extended conversation with Richie Port, covering the rest of his career beyond the 2010 Giro, which we spoke about in Monday's rest day episode. So if you want more Richie Port and more Max Sciandri, become a friend of the podcast at thecyclingpodcast.com. But what are we going to hear now, Lionel?
Well, let's hear first a little bit from Max Sciandri on riding the Giro for the McCartney team. But first we're going to hear from John Deering, who was the team's press officer at that Giro d'Italia, first of all about a visit to meet the Pope before the Giro, and then about what happened on FA Cup final day. It's relevant to the Giro because it was also the day that the Linda McCartney team won a stage courtesy of David McKenzie. So first John Deering and then Max Sciandri on that Giro.
The Italians were horrified because all the other teams had really nice suits and stuff, and we'd been told we were getting Portsmouth suits, all done and dusted deal. Of course, no sign of them. We ran in our track suits. Oh, Blake, Max is just so ashamed. Such a big deal for those guys, you know. It's like going to your wedding in shorts, I think.
So let's go back to May the 20th, Saturday, May the 20th, 2000. What was significant?
I know, it's a massive day in my life because, obviously, there was a huge event on that day, and that was Chelsea beating Aston Villa in the cup final. That's what you want me to talk about, isn't it?
Well, yeah, I mean, it was a massive day all round, wasn't it? Chelsea, your football team, were at Wembley, and, well, you weren't there, were you? You couldn't go to the match.
No, we had... So there were two big Chelsea supporters at the team, myself and Chris Lillywhite, who's the assistant manager, to assistant DS, sorry, or second DS to Sean Yates. So I managed to get a ticket for the final, and he went back for the game. Keith Lambert, who's like the third DS, was in England. He came out that morning. They swapped over at, where do we start? They probably went to Pescara or somewhere like that on the Adriatic coast. And Keith thought he was getting a short straw, but it'd be a nice little holiday in Italy. We're talking about, it must have been the second Saturday of the race, right?
That's right, yeah.
So I went back for the cup final, and I stayed a bit miserable. But my commitment was, he said I had to wear my shirt. I had a Chelsea shirt, so I wore that for the day. And that was it.
Well, it wasn't quite it, was it? It was stage seven of the race. It went from Vasto, as you say, on the Adriatic coast, to Teramo. It was 182 kilometres. It was a pretty flat stage, but it ended up being quite eventful.
It was one of those stages. There was no big hills, but it was a bit like, where would it be like riding around here? No big hills, but you were always either going up or going down around a corner, so that sort of day, you know. Sean phoned me up from first team car to say that Dave McKenzie had attacked. Basically, Sean said, Dave's got a chance of getting the Intergiro with this attack. We thought, that's cool. We were one of the smaller teams in the race. And I remember talking to Dave afterwards. He said the first 20 minutes or so, he said, it was appalling because he was about 80 yards in front of the punch the whole time. And you just think, oh, I feel so stupid, I might as well sit up. But no, I've been thinking about giving it a go. And basically, they just chased him all day.
Now, you kept up your part of the bargain with Chris Lillywhite. You wore your Chelsea shirt all day.
I did.
And then what happened as you got to the finish in Teramo and you were, as often happens with people in press capacities in cycling teams, you kind of become part press person, part soigneur, part of the finish line crew. What did you do?
I think we had total staff, full-time staff for a professional cycling team was about 15, including the riders. When he came through the finish, we just the telly had been on, just focusing on the bunch for ages. There was no time gaps on there, and all the as you know, the Giro was much more it was much more of a domestic race in those days, wasn't it? And all the Italian Soigneur, we were in the Soigneur's area, just through the finish line watching this TV, and they're all super cool. They got their sleeves rolled up to get tans just right, and everybody's super relaxed, you know. TV came on Dave, and me and Pete just went, screaming at the screen. You just don't do that. It's really, really uncool.
And when he crossed the line, you were one of the first people to him?
You don't really think about what you're going to do in those situations. It'd be nice if you could be like Richard Veronk and have your celebrations all planned out. But I just was sort of... I looked like a fat kid on a bouncy castle, I think. And grabbed hold of him as he came over the line. And I think he was crying, I was crying. And Sean, he pulled the car into deviation and just legged it over the barriers and grabbed him as well. And he was crying. Unbelievable, really. It was a special day.
And, well, there was a small recrimination for the fact you were wearing a Chelsea shirt rather than an official Linda McCartney or top.
Yeah, I got in the shit. What a day. Chelsea win a cup, we win a race, and sort of walking on air, absolute bollocking on the phone for not wearing team kit.
I picked out one of the stages here in Prato, and I remember it was a long day, 260K, and we got into Prato and I asked second, Axel Merckx won it. He just made a little move, like a K before the finish. So that was pretty disappointing. Then McKenzie won the stage with a great breakaway, I think, after. And it's just, for me, you know, we didn't get a penny or euro, whatever it was in the days, because the whole thing went bankrupt with that guy who was running the show. But I had a lot of good memories. You know, Pascal was there. Sean Yates was the coach. I remember Sean getting up at like 5 a.m, riding 3 hours on the rollers as a DS. And it was just a good team. We had a lot of fun. It was a vegetarian team, you know. Obviously, had Linda McCartney products, vegetarian. So I did the whole Giro. I didn't eat one slice of prosciutto. I just stuck with what they gave me. You know, we had a team of chefs actually in that Giro, and they didn't cook nothing of vegetarian. But the funny story is, I went to Down Under, and then you know, when you go to the presentation party the first day, they're offering these little barbecue meat, and I just grab one, and it's kangaroo meat, and I'm just about to bite it, and it's like, oh shit, I'm in a vegetarian team. I put it down. But obviously, when I came home, I had my nice steaks, you know, and bistecca.
Florentine. Yeah. You like a Florentine steak?
Fiorentina, for sure, yeah.
Well, it was an eventful Giro for the Linda McCartney team, and an interesting subject, something I've written about before for the cycling anthology, and something I might revisit for the podcast, maybe for a friend special at some point, tell the story of the team's rise and demise. It was pretty spectacular, both on the way up and on the way down.
Well, I mean, there's so much to say about the Linda McCartney team, I suppose, from the involvement in the first place of, you know, pop royalty, Linda McCartney. And there were these pictures, I remember, of the team at the McCartney estate meeting Paul and Linda when it was set up. Julian Clark, the man in charge, he eventually went to prison, didn't he? They had sort of phantom sponsorship agreements, and the team collapsed the following year. There were doping allegations around the team as well, which have led to sort of investigations. It seems it doesn't seem very thorough investigations into what went on at that team. So a friend special would be a great idea, Lionel. I know you've kind of talked about and covered the Linda McCartney story quite a lot over the years, but there's probably still quite a lot to say.
I've been eating some Linda McCartney food on my during lockdown. I'm stuck in the UK, and I didn't realise it was still going, the old Linda McCartney.
I didn't realise that either, actually.
Meatballs, Linda McCartney faux meatballs, faux sausages, very good, actually.
Max Sciandri's dog, of course, swears by it, doesn't he? Woof, woof, he said in response. That's a whole other story. That'll make it into your friend's special.
But it wouldn't be a Giro without controversy, would it? I mean, every Giro has its controversies, even our Giro.
Apparently so, yeah. There is a controversy, a scandal bubbling away in our Giro, we believe.
Well, we're going to be following this story, aren't we, over the next few days?
Yeah,
we've got a couple of ex-pros riding, and they've blown the whistle. We've got a Christophe Basson of our Giro. Someone has blown the whistle on what they suspect to be some cheating going on.
They suspect Lionel of maybe putting in a weight that's too high.
I have lost weight over the first week of our Giro, legitimately.
Reverse weight doping. Don't know why you would do that. Anyway, I look forward to hearing more about the developing scandal on our Giro over the next few days. What have we got coming up tomorrow, Daniel?
Well, Rich, tomorrow, from a purely geographical point of view, we're going from Ravenna, home of lasagne, I think. Did we have lasagna there last year, napalm?
We did. Anyway, it was huge, wasn't it? I couldn't manage it. I mean, I was beaten by the size of the portion. It was just too much. It was like a breeze block of lasagna, really dense and very rich. I mean, it was excellent, but just maybe they looked at me and thought I needed feeding up a bit.
Lasagna, of course, famously the only pasta that was available at the start of lockdown in the UK, wasn't it? Because it's just too difficult.
Oh, yeah. And we are actually going to be talking about lockdown and all things coronavirus, because we're on our way to Padova tomorrow. We're going to take a detour, and there's a range of hills just outside Padova called the Colli Euganei, and one of the first outbreaks in Italy, and in fact the first victim of coronavirus died in that area. And we're going to be talking about the impact of COVID-19. We're going to go back to the last race, the last important race that took place, Paris-Nice, and we're going to be talking to the last race winner, which was Max Schachmann. And we're also going to be talking to someone from a World Tour team who had a very different and unpleasant experience of those first couple of weeks when the virus was spreading around the world.
And of course, Shachman had a very prominent role on a very important day in recent Giro history, which is a day that we'll, or an episode that we'll cover in one of our episodes in the final week of our Giro. So that'll set that one up nicely as well. We're gonna say a few thank yous to friends of the podcast. Thank you very much, everybody who's signed up as a friend at thecyclingpodcast.com. I've been shipping out lots of signed books as well. If you become a good friend of the podcast, or even just a friend of the podcast, you can get a copy of our book, The Grand Tour Diaries. Perfect for lockdown. If you pay a little bit extra as a friend, you'll get a signed copy. Unfortunately, at the moment, it'll only be signed by me, but hopefully that's okay. And as I say, the Max Sciandri interview, the full interview, is available for friends of the podcast. We're going to say a few thank yous, but following that, will be played out by François Thomazeau, who is sort of paying homage to the Linda McCartney team with a Beatles song, and looking ahead to, again, another episode that we'll be playing in the final week of the Giro from a recent Giro. Sorry, in the final week of our Giro from a recent Giro. But before we go, big thank you from me to Charles Bournazian, Matthias Frederiksen, Thomas Still, Steve Crabb, Harry Walton, and Laurent Audibert.
Laurent has actually overtaken me a couple of days running on the stage of our Giro on RGT. So he waved both times as he went past. A big thank you from me to Eric Johnson, Jonathan Davis, Nick Bentley, Stephen Carr, Sean Gordon, and John Boosnell.
And a big thanks from me to Maggie Brown, Jim Watt, Carl Langenbach, James Forrest, Massimo Bonfio, Ian Brown. It's not my kind of music, but I don't think it's
a different spelling. Anyway. Scottish spelling of Ian there. Okay. Yeah. Thanks, Ian.
Boy, you're gonna carry that weight, carry that weight for a long time. Boy, you're gonna carry that weight, carry that weight. I never give you my feeling, I only send you my invitation. And in the middle of the celebrations, I break down. Boy, you're gonna carry that weight, you carry that weight for a long time. Boy, you gotta carry that weight, carry that weight alone. This was one of the shortest songs by the Beatles called Carry That Weight. It's funny because it's so short and everybody seems to remember it. I mean, it's part of a kind of motto they have in there. In one of their last albums. And I don't know when I... ever since I've seen Tom Dumoulin's episode in the Giro, when he had to kind of carry that weight before kind of delivering it or getting rid of it, that famous day on the Giro, I'm thinking about that song, you know, with all head one day riding a bike or doing something else to carry that kind of weight. Anyway, there you are. Carried That Way by the Beatles was my song for today's our Giro. Cheers, guys.